everybody. How are you this morning? Oh, good. That's good. Well, we have some announcements to make. And let's see here. The upper room for September, October is here. You may pick one up from the shelf in the narthex. And the annual church picnic is only 3 weeks away. It'll be held on Sunday, September the 22nd, after the church service. We are planning a potluck and we'll be grilling hot dogs, Mets and Brats. Drinks will be provided. If you have not done so already, please sign up on the sheet on the snack table in the narthex to let us know how many plan to attend, and also the side dishes or dessert you will be bringing. The Lunch Bunch will be meeting at 11:30 a.m. on Tuesday, September the 10th, at the Cabana on the River. In case of cold or rainy weather, we will meet at the Price Hill Chili on Glenway Avenue instead. If you plan to attend, please call Carol Thomas, my wife, by Monday, September the 11th. And then thank you for your many donations of school supplies and personal care items for students of Delshire Elementary School. Your generosity is really appreciated by the students and staff. Finally, thank you to all who contributed to the Presbyterian Giving Program we supported this past spring. This is the first year we chose one of the programs to support. We donated $300 for a family of chickens for a year. This provided eggs for food, feathers for pillows, and fertilizer for the crops. This helps improve food security and livelihoods of families around the world. Thank you for your continuing generous support of For His Glory Food Pantry. For the month of August, we are collecting bath tissues, facial tissues, and paper towels. And then finally, there's a need for helpers and teachers for children. How about that? Children, oh, wonderful. Please sign up in the narthex if you would like to help with the children's programs. All righty. Now then, will you follow along with the call to worship this morning? Who may abide in the tent of the Lord? Who may dwell upon his holy hill? Those who walk blamelessly and do what is right and speak truth from their hearts. God's royal scepter is a scepter of equity. He loves righteousness and hates wickedness. Throne of the Lord will endure forever.
And now, I invite our children to come forward for a brief time for children. Come on up, y'all. How have y'all been this week?
Good.
I haven't seen y'all in a couple weeks, actually. So y'all been doing well? Had a lot going on? So let me tell you, do you know what my favorite part of school was? Lunch. I loved lunchtime. Well, there were other parts I did too. You guys like lunchtime? What's that?
I like lunch recess and when we have special gym.
All right, special. Oh, those all sound like fun. Yep, I loved recess too. But whenever we went to eat lunch, we always had to do one thing first. Do you know what that might be? And it's always something good to do before you eat.
Prayer.
Well, prayer's good, but what do you think?
Wash your hands.
That's right, wash your hands. Well, in today's gospel reading, Jesus was talking with some men, and they said that in order to be a good person, you needed to wash your hands. Well, the thing is, Jesus responded. He said, washing your hands might be important, but it doesn't make you a good person. You know what? Washing our hands is good for keeping us healthy, but it doesn't automatically make us be a good person. So what Jesus tells us is that what we really need to do to be clean in our hearts is to believe in him and to treat other people like He would want us to treat them, to take care of them, to be nice to people, to share. And so I invite you to think about that as you go into this week. Think about ways that maybe you can reach out to people who may be sitting by themselves at lunch, people who may not have enough food to bring and you need to share something with them. There are lots of ways that you can help out other people. And that, Jesus says, is what really makes us clean in our hearts instead of just in our hands. So let's say a prayer. Please repeat after me, and the congregation is welcome to join as well. Dear God, we thank you for Jesus and all of his teachings. Help us to treat others as you would want us to, so that we may be clean in heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, let y'all go to Children's Church. I think you're going to talk about Moses and the Red Sea today. So have fun.
Now then, will you follow along with me in the opening prayer of confession? Merciful God, we confess that we have not lived according to your word. We have ignored righteousness and embraced wickedness, defiling your creation, ourselves included, in our pursuit of earthly pleasures. Plant in our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion. Nourish us with all goodness. Grant us the strength to withstand temptation and bring forth in us the fruit of good works.
Amen. Hear the good news. The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you, in the name of Jesus Christ, that we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
We are forgiven, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God, thanks be to God. We are forgiven.
Our epistle lesson today is from James, chapter 1, verses 12 to 27, and I'm speaking from the New Revised Standard Version. Hear God's word as I share it with you. Blessed is anyone who endures temptation. Such a one has stood the test and will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. No one, when tempted, should say, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, and he himself tempts no one. But one is tempted by one's own desire, being lured and enticed by it. Then, when desire has conceived, it engenders sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, gives birth to death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers and sisters. Every generous act of giving, with every perfect gift, is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. In fulfillment of his own purposes, he gave birth to us by the word of truth, so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creatures. You must understand this, my beloved brothers and sisters. Let everyone be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger, for human anger does not produce God's righteousness. Therefore, rid yourself of all sordidness and rank growth of wickedness, and welcome with meekness the implanted word that has the power to save your souls. But be doers of the word, and not merely hearers who deceive themselves. For if any are hearers of the word and not doers, they are like those who look at themselves in a mirror. For they look at themselves and on going away, immediately forget what they were like. For those who look into the perfect law, the law of liberty, and persevere, being not hearers who forget, but doers who act, they will be blessed in their doing. If any think they are religious and do not bridle their tongues, but deceive their hearts, their religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to care for orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you.
We will indeed live by the word of God. So I invite you now to listen and follow along with me from Mark 7, verses 1 to 23. Now when the Pharisees and some of the scribes who had come from Jerusalem gathered around him, they noticed that some of his disciples were eating with defiled hands, that is, without washing them. For the Pharisees and all the Jews did not eat unless they washed their hands, thus observing the tradition of the elders. And they did not eat anything from the market unless they wash, and there are also many other traditions that they observe, the washing of cups and pots and bronze kettles and beds. So the Pharisees and the scribes asked him, "Why do your disciples not walk according to the tradition of the elders, but eat with defiled hands?" He said to them, "Isaiah prophesied rightly about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching human precepts as doctrines. You abandon the commandment of God and hold to human tradition.'" Then he said to them, "You have a fine way of rejecting the commandment of God in order to keep your tradition. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and your mother,' and 'Whoever speaks evil of father or mother must surely die.' But you say that if anyone tells father or mother, 'Whatever support you might have had for me is korban,' that is, an offering to God, then you no longer permit doing anything for a father or mother, thus nullifying the word of God through your tradition that you have handed on. And you do many things like this." Then he called the crowd again and said to them, "Listen to me, all of you, and understand. There is nothing outside a person that can, by going in, can defile, but the things that come out are what defile." When he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about the parable. He said to them, "So, are you also without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into a person from outside cannot defile, since it enters not the heart, but the stomach, and goes out into the sewer?" Thus he declared all foods clean. And he said, "It is what comes out of a person that defiles. For it is from within, from the human heart, that evil intentions come. Sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, avarice, wickedness, deceit, debauchery, envy, slander, pride, folly. All these evil things come from within, and they defile a person." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. This passage is significant when it comes to literary talk, in that it's one of the few passages where the author includes his own commentary. In some cases, such comments might be suspected to be later additions, but here, biblical scholars agree that these explanatory notes are original to Mark himself. He clearly wanted the readers, regardless of whether they were Jews familiar with the law or Gentiles who are completely foreign to it, to have a bit of context. But why is this so important? Is this passage even relevant to those of us who no longer follow the rabbinical laws? We'll discuss that, but spoiler alert, the answer is yes. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as the centuries and millennia pass, your word never loses its relevancy. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O Rock and Redeemer. Amen. A Baptist friend of mine, who has since been retired from ministry for several years now, about 20, 30 years ago was pastoring two small churches, and eventually, after a great deal of discussion, the churches decided that their future would rely on them merging. Now, for those of you who were around in for the time of the merger here between St. John's and Westminster, you'll probably know that there's a lot of negotiating that goes into making a merger happen. Now, in this case, the merger was completely ready to go, except for one thing they were hung up on. Which cross was going to go in the sanctuary? Church A, who was going to be selling their building, felt that they should be allowed to bring their cross into the church. But Church B, where they would be worshiping from then on, was extremely reluctant to give up theirs. They were extremely proud of their cross, though they realized that nobody really knew where it had come from. There were all sorts of stories, of course, but the only thing that could be agreed upon was that it had been in the church as long as anyone could remember. Both sides felt so strongly about the issue that the merger even risked falling through. In an effort to gather more information about this cross in Church B, my friend the pastor climbed to the top of the ladder and took it off the wall. He paused, turned to the congregation, and said with a mix of astonishment and maybe slight annoyance, "Did anybody else realize that this was made out of tinfoil?" Nobody else had realized that. But they did realize something that day, that regardless of material that the cross might have been made out of, it was not worth sacrificing the future of the two churches for. It was an argument really about one's identity, not about the significance of the cross, but of one's tradition, of holding on to some tradition. Now, the ritual of hand washing that we read about in the gospel is believed to have been developed, at least in part, as a symbol of identity, just like Church B's cross. For the early Israelites, establishing rules about washing their hands and eating only certain types of food was a way for them to demonstrate that they were cleaner or purer than those who worshipped false gods. And as time went on, these rituals moved from being supportive actions to taking center stage. Whenever misfortune struck the Israelites, they would rationalize it by blaming themselves for having failed to follow these laws sufficiently. Now, as someone who attended the temple regularly, Jesus would have been well aware of these customs and rituals. And since the gospel tells us that, quote, only some of his disciples were not following the custom, I don't think it's that unlikely that Christ himself might have been following this hand-washing ritual himself. Furthermore, you will note that it's the Pharisees who called the disciples out first on this matter. Christ did not come intending to upturn this tradition and throw it away entirely. Rather, he responds to them, criticizing them not about the tradition, but with the legalistic ways that the Pharisees have held themselves to. He points out that this has even led them to hypocrisy, specifically calling out their relationship with a practice called Korban. Now, Korban was a type of offering set aside for the temple, which meant that it was unable to be used anywhere else. Say I had $50, and I wanted to give that to the church. I would write it off and say, that $50 is going to go to the church. It can't be used for anything else. Now, in this case, Christ, again, is not unhappy about setting aside money for the church. What he's unhappy about is when people come to people in need, such as children's parents who need financial assistance, and the children respond by saying, oh, I can't help you. That money's set aside for the temple. So, with this in mind, we can understand that Christ's main concern really was with using these traditions as a way to exclude others, as a way to take advantage of one's own wealth. Now, we all still wash our hands, or at least I would hope so. But our covenant with Christ means that spiritually, these Davidical laws no longer have the same meaning to us. However, that does not mean that in the 21st century, we are any less prone to obsession with ritual. Fahmy Perkins, who for over 50 years has been professor of theology at Boston College, writes, "Religious groups can easily sacrifice faith to save the tradition, even when everyone knows that the tradition in question was established by human beings, not God. Our church is full of rituals. Every Sunday we meet here at 10 a.m., maybe earlier if you're helping out or singing in the choir. We sing hymns, we say prayers, you listen to me yak for about 10 to 15 minutes, and then we have our fellowship hour after the service. On special occasions, like today, we're going to celebrate communion. Other times we might have a baptism. We may light Advent candles. We may do an imposition of ashes on Ash Wednesday. And all of these traditions have a theological significance. Don't get me wrong. But, at least in our Reformed tradition, the manner in which we practice them is left up to the individuals in each congregation. Because of this, I find the criticism that many Christians have of Judaism, namely that it is a religion overly concerned with ritual, as unfair and perhaps even hypocritical. When I was in college, I helped to lead the music at the Temple of the High Country, which was the local synagogue. One day when I was walking down to the temple, it started raining, just out of nowhere, a complete downpour. And by the time I got to the synagogue, my feet were completely soaked. I asked the lay pastor, lay leader there, Chuck, if it would be all right if I took my socks and shoes off to let them dry. He shared with me that usually entering a house of worship in such a manner was frowned upon. But in this case, he said, it was necessary so that my feet wouldn't get blisters. He explained to me that this was consistent with a concept called pikuach nefesh, which holds that a person's health and safety takes precedence over all other laws. As we read in our passage from James, our first and foremost purpose as humans is to represent Christ. Sometimes this means altering or even giving up our traditions when they interfere with our mission to serve others in Christ's name. Because everywhere we look, we have rituals and traditions. From worship on Sunday morning, throughout the week as they go on. Rituals, as we know, are not exclusive to religion. Every day we're thinking things and saying things and acting in ways that may seem harmless but have the potential to draw us away from Christ. So, I ask that in this week to come, you remember that James tells us to live our lives as first fruits, as offerings to God. Let us always consistently be mindful that our practices, both within worship on Sunday morning and throughout our daily lives, center around praise and obedience to God, and not the other way around. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand and join me in affirming our faith using the Westminster Confession of Faith. We cannot, by our best works, merit pardon of sin or eternal life at the hand of God because of the great disproportion that is between them and the glory to come, and the infinite distance that is between us and God, whom by them we can neither profit nor satisfy for the debt of our former sins. But when we have done all we can, we have done but our duty and are unprofitable servants. And because, as they are good, they proceed from his Spirit, and as they were wrought by us, they are defiled and mixed with so much weakness and imperfection that they cannot endure the severity of God's judgment. In the unity of the Godhead, there be three persons of one substance, power, and eternity. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The Father is of none, neither begotten nor proceeding. The Son is eternally begotten of the Father. The Holy Ghost eternally proceeding from the Father and the Son. Amen.
Amen.
The letter of James tells us that in fulfillment of God's purpose, we are birthed by the word of truth so that we would become a kind of first fruits of his creation, of his creatures. Out of thanksgiving, we offer our own first fruits to God.
Praise
pray. Triune God, the earth and all that is in it belongs to you. Accept these offerings as a token of our thanksgiving for your sacrifice, which we remember as we receive your gifts of wine and bread. Amen. You may be seated. This is not the table of St. John's Westminster Church. It's not the table of the PCUSA or the United Church of Christ. It is the table of Jesus Christ, and it is open to everyone. For those of you who are watching online, I invite you, as you're able, to grab some bread and juice, or whatever you may have around the house, and when the time comes, to take communion alongside us. Friends, this is a joyful feast of the people of God. They will come from east and west and from north and south and sit at table in the kingdom of God. On the night he was betrayed, Lord Jesus broke bread. After giving thanks to God, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of it, do this in remembrance of me." Every time that you eat this bread and you drink of this cup, you proclaim the saving death of the risen Lord until he comes again. Let us pray. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and upon these your gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break and the cup we bless may be the communion of the body and blood of Christ. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, that we may be one with all who share this feast, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us out to be the body of Christ in the world. We pray for our brethren who are sick or injured, for those who struggle with depression and loneliness, for those who feel like there's nothing left for them in this world. Grant them peace of mind and pour out your healing power upon them. On this Labor Day weekend, we give thanks for all workers everywhere, particularly those whom we encounter every day, but who receive little to no recognition. We remember those who have fought and continue to fight for fair workplaces and employment opportunities for all. With your help, O Lord, may all people have access to vocations that provide both joy and economic security. May your church always honor the presence of the Lord in the humble and the suffering. And may we learn to recognize each other as brothers and sisters, gathered together around the table of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is the body of Christ, broken for you. the cup of salvation poured for you. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you that you have fed us in this sacrament, united us with Christ, and given us a foretaste of the heavenly banquet in your eternal kingdom. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Before I give the benediction, I have one more celebration I forgot to share. Today is Charlie, the guide dog's birthday, turned 6. So, Charlie, we wish you a happy birthday, and we thank you for all that you do. And now, as we go into the world, do not just be hearers of the word, but doers. Remember that you are beloved children of God, and make that clear to those around you in all that you say and do. And may the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you until we meet again. Amen.